When I thought of you and I talking together, I don't know who's chef and who's math, it could be either way. But the idea that, you know, street art, fashion, graphic design, whatever you want to call it, is a bit of a matchup, but it's hopefully a friendly matchup. And I think that there's a number of people in this world that, like Jeff, who have outshined people who he may have been a fan of at a certain point, which myself included, in terms of getting a very broad audience with something that a handful of us started down the path of, like, we didn't know what the hell we were doing when we did it, but trying to make our way in graphic design and in hip hop. And really, my whole thing about hip hop is I was a punk kid and I went to a record shop that I always went to buy punk records. And, you know, right next to Bad Brains was an album by Public Enemy, a group I had never heard of. And I had heard, like, you know, a bunch of different rap music back in the day, whatever, because I was young enough or old enough now to listen to it. And, you know, there's something that spoke to me about Public Enemy that was very different than anything I'd ever heard. And it felt as punk as anything I'd ever done. And that opened the door for so much.
Yeah.
And hip hop, to me, just took on a life of its own. And I gravitated towards it immediately.
One thing you always did that I love and I was highly influenced by is your ability to take a lyric out of a song, pull it out, and then subverse it in a way that maybe the rapper didn't necessarily mean, but right, by you taking it out and making an art piece out of it, you made it something different.
Right, which is really commonplace now. Like, there's a lot of people doing it, and it's very creative, and it, like, there's a lot of great stuff on Instagram and people's Twitter websites and Twitter and Tumblr where people are doing it really well. But yeah, back in the day, like, I started to do that because I was enthralled with the language of hip hop. Like, I always go back to this saying, which I did not put up here, but like, ski goggles and bubble goose downs, that was a fun thing to say and a fun thing to draw and a fun thing to type out on the computer. So it's those things that I like to pull. I'd like to pull because I was a graphic designer and I wasn't an artist, so I had to have content. I met Sir and I met PNB Nation and all the guys from there, and like, the most amazing cats that were out there, Futura, Stash, Gerb, these groups that were like, they had the same mentality I had. And so I found my tribe, as it were, in the LES. And you found yours years later, but in the same vein.
Like, I was 2.0 to you.
Right, you were 2.0, but it was like very close to that, you know?
And it's always amazing to us, you know, who now we exist in a world where blogs and magazines have like multi-million follows, and you have like Agenda trade show where there's like, you know, 1,000 brands exhibiting at Agenda that all are in this category where it was, as he mentioned, it was one, like the 555 Soul Store on Ludlow was like the size of that under the stairs, like just a little alleyway, and its founder, Camilla, was just in the back sewing.
It's in the
hats.
Back sewing.
That was the birthplace of it, you know, or one of the birthplaces.
One of the birthplaces,
And so now to see like what's happening to all of this is mind-boggling in like 15 to 25 years, you know, 15, 20 years.
I mean, literally you can make a t-shirt tonight, have it online tomorrow, and sell 1,000 tomorrow.
Yeah.
Whereas it used to take like the Phillies blunt shirt, I always use as the example of like, it took months for that shirt to catch on.
Yeah.
Imagine if that shirt had been born now.
Right.
It would be an overnight success. You'd have it, you'd be able to buy it in Japan tomorrow.
Yeah.
And now it took years to get that one shirt to make any amount of money.
Right.
You know? This is just a quote that always has stuck with me. I mean, it's a graffiti quote. It's been said by many people. It's a hip-hop quote. I mean, Nas, everyone has said it, but I mean, this is really what it was all about, even from an early age for me, and I think everyone who participates in like POW And in the culture that surrounds POWW, or that POWW surrounds, this is like a big deal. You know, I see people, you know, all the painters and stuff, like putting their Instagrams up as they paint their walls, because it's important to know who's doing it, even in the process.
Yeah.
So people aren't going around going, you know, just wondering who these people are, right, and randomly putting it up there. So I think that whether you write your name or your tag or your label, yeah, like you have, this has always been one of the end goals. And I'm not sure, for me as a 22-year-old coming out of college, like, I didn't think of money. I think maybe kids think of money more, but mm-hmm, I thought of this. Like, yeah. And then I thought, the money will take care of itself if I do this.
Yeah.
Which we all know doesn't happen.
Do you get
money?
No.
I lose it.
No, but like, I've always struggled with the original core idea of getting your name out there, like graffiti bombing a train and having the train, right, travel all cities. And that idea versus the sellout idea of creating something and then having it available all over the world, which to me is the ultimate form of getting up and succeeding. Right. Like when you do a shoe and it's on the side of a Converse and it's available in Paris, isn't that the ultimate form of getting up? But then on the other hand, you have people saying like, no, you're a sellout. So have you like struggled with that?
Well, yeah, no, I think everyone struggles with that, because like another slide we could have put up there is, my kids got to eat. You know, I mean, that's the basic premise of the purpose of this game, is to tell the world my name. Like, it got interrupted by the fact that I had to eat.
Uh-huh.
If I didn't have to eat, yeah, I could have done that sooner.
Yeah.
You know, and if I didn't have to pay for stuff,
yeah,
then I could have done that sooner.
Right, right.
So I think it gets in the way, but I do think that, you know, it's funny because we're painting on walls here, which, yeah, is like 10 years ago would be crazy.
Uh-huh.
We all know that. But maybe 15 years ago would have been crazy, because really the T-shirt took over for like the train, you know,
yeah,
like
in the wall.
The best,
yeah,
way to get your name up there was to get a T-shirt out there. Right. Now it's a shoe. Now it's a wall again.
Yeah.
So it's this cyclical thing.
Right.
So it is the company you keep. And when I talk to students, like art students, or even people who come in and apply for a job or something, like, you are the company you keep. There's no question about that. Like, the fact that it's the people that I have known in my life,
yeah,
that's almost more important than what I've done.
Yeah.
But it's like, if you're doing work and you're with people, so like POWW is a great example of the company you keep.
Yeah.
And the people that work here and work with the group and work with the guys, like, it is something that will reward you, mm-hmm, you know, in the future. And the fact that you're meeting artists and you're meeting people and you're being cool with them and not,
yeah,
trying to be assholes around them, like, that's going to go a long way.
Right.
And so that for me has been sort of this life lesson of like, the guys I went to school with, you know, have stayed with me for my whole life. And then the people that I've grown up with, or the people that I've been brands with, like a 555 Soul or a Sir or a Staple, yeah, or anybody else, those are the people that you sort of stick with. And
right,
those are the people that help you,
yeah,
become better you.
Yeah.
You
know? And I also want to add that, you know, for those of you who are starting a brand or are even fanatical about this culture, like, don't forget to look up from your phone every once in a while and see the people around you. And these are going to be like your future crew, your posse, and your tribe coming, yeah, up. Do you have friends in that have nothing to do with art or creativity? And then like I have friends who are like doctors and like real estate agents and stuff. And when I catch up with them, they're like, "So Jeff, how's that T-shirt business going?" Like,
yeah,
they just like put you into like, yeah, you're the hip hop designer.
No, it definitely. I mean, you know, other parents that are friends of my kids that,
yeah,
have no idea what I do.
I'm sure PTA meetings are interesting.
And they just have no clue. And they're like, "My daughter follows you on Instagram. What are you doing in Paris?" You know, like,
that's creepy.
It's complicated. This is a good one, because this is what I teach my kids. If you could draw Garfield, you could make a living. That's point blank. Mm-hmm. Like, you see it, like, if you could draw Charlie Brown, you can make a living. If you could draw Garfield, two eyes and a nose and a little thing, it's like, there's something for you there.
Yeah.
It's just, you got to figure out what it is.
Right.
But it's something that, like, I've taught both my daughters how to draw Garfield, because I just feel like, hey, if it doesn't work out, you could draw Garfield. Uh-huh. And I don't know what that means, but it's worked for me. Right. So. This is a quote by a young lady in Atlanta when I was going through the airport, and she must have been 20, 22, maybe, let's assume, and she's like a security guard. And she just looks at my ID for like ever and just looks at me and looks at my ID and looks at me and looks at my ID and looks at me. And then she says this.
You dress young.
You dress young. and it spelled that way because that's the way she said it.
Right.
In Atlanta, you dress young.
Yeah.
And I was like, can I go now? Eat your eggs or I'll break your legs. This is the famous quote from Beat Street. My favorite movie quote probably of all time. I do these monster characters, and this is how the monster characters started, believe it or not, because they basically like, eat your eggs, I'll break your legs. My 12-year-old daughter, who was then like 5 or something, didn't eat her lunch at all. Uh-huh. So I started making these monster characters because I was just a graphic designer. I drew some character design, but I never drew monsters like I do now. And I just basically drew them and stuck them in her lunch every day. And it started with eat your eggs or I'll break your legs, which in retrospect could have been bad.
Abusive. Yeah,
yeah, abusive. If you didn't get the Beat Street reference, which I'm sure her kindergarten preschool teacher did not get it. So anyway, that's how it started. Like I put these in every day and then she liked them more. And then eventually a show came along, a group show, and I didn't have any work to show, so I put all together all these monsters and sent it as a piece. And then Pedro Winter from Ed Rec, Ed Banger Records, actually bought the piece like literally a minute into the show. We did not know each other at that point at all. And he bought that piece right away. And then he's like, I want more of this. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, why do you want more of that? It's my daughter's. Like, I told him the story. He's like, okay, I want even more of that. And then that's how they kind of started. And they became, you know, a little bit of a second life.
Yeah.
So this is another, like, student thing. The grass is always greener. So one of the most asked questions I get, like, where was your favorite place to work? Mm-hmm. You know, like, what was your favorite job ever? Like, was Nike the coolest place you ever worked? No. It was not.
Right.
Was Stussy the coolest place you ever worked? No. Every place you work,
yeah,
you think is going to be the coolest place that you work, and it all has drawbacks. I think POW to me embodies the goal of like where at least I personally started.
Uh-huh.
The idea that like a POW Hawaii thing can happen and be like, we're making our own way in this world.
Yeah.
We know that there's a big Wynwood thing, and we know there's a art world out there that's controlling a lot of what happens. And you know, there's billboard companies out there that own, you know, rights and landlords and everything else. But to see it happen here, like it's happening, and to see people like doing for self,
yeah,
and creating their own language and their own world. That's kind of what I started out doing, and that's, I know what you did with Staple is like, you see a place, you see a need in the world,
mm-hmm.
and then you go and fill it,
you know?
You know, a bunch of people here at POW, like everyone here, for the most part, owns like their look and feel,
yeah.
and they have like characters that they do, or uh-huh. they like...
They're known for it, yeah.
Yeah, there is that sense of like, you make something that someone can't take from you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's, I think that's the... As I approach my twilight years,
yes,
you got to have something. That's one of your
the
end
lasting
goals,
thing.
I think.
Yeah, for sure.
To have something that is only you. No one can take that from you. You know.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone. Let's give a round of applause to Kevin Lyons.
Jeffstaple, everybody.